This evening we're in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9, verses 28 to 36. If you have your Bibles, turn there, Luke chapter 9, verse 28 to 36. And if you'd stand with me as we read God's Word. Also, if you don't have a Bible, we'd love to give you a Bible. If you want to raise your hand, if you need a Bible, we'll get you one. And you are more than welcome to keep it. That will be for you. There's one over here. If we get one over here, one over there. One right there. More than welcome to have one and keep it. It's always great to have God's Word. Luke chapter 9, verse 28 to 36. Beginning in verse 28, we will read, and then I will pray, and then we will dive right in. Beginning verse 28. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, he took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered, and his clothing became dazzling white. And behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep. But when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. And as the men were parting from him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make 3 tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. And as he was saying these things, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent and told no one in those days anything of what they had seen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for every soul here tonight, Lord. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that we all affirm it's your orchestration that we're even breathing in this room right now. And we thank you, Lord, that you have something in store for us to receive from you, the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, we can't receive that unless our ears are open. Our eyes are open, our hearts are open, Lord. Just as these disciples were woken up from sleep, Lord, wake us up from sleep. Awaken our eyes. Make us sensitive to your ministering hand, Lord, upon us. Lord, those that are in here that need encouragement, Jesus, would you comfort and encourage? Lord, those of us that we need conviction, we need exhortation, we need a call to repentance, Lord, make that true. Lord God, we desire to be different. More different than how we've come in this evening as we leave. And so, Lord, we know that only your word can do that, only your spirit. Lord, that ministry working hand in hand in us and through us. Lord, I want to receive that tonight. I know we do as well. And so we ask that you do that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's good to be with you all. It's been a couple of weeks. This evening, what we're looking at, as we already got a preview of, we're looking at really one of the greatest events of history, one of the greatest events in history. And I don't want to be overtly kind of superlative. I don't want to say, you know, it's easy to look at the Gospels and look at the ministry of Jesus and just be just so excited about each miracle and so excited about each teaching that I say, this is the best, this is the best, this is the best. I don't want to be superlative, but really this is true. This is one of the greatest events that we find in the Gospels. Looking at the Transfiguration of Jesus tonight. Recently, a few months ago, maybe you guys remember, Pastor Mike Neglia, who's the pastor of Calvary Cork in Ireland, was here with us on a Sunday. He was visiting, and he spoke on the Transfiguration account in the Gospel of Mark. This evening, of course, we're looking at the Transfiguration account of the Gospel of Luke, and he's one of my dearest friends. We pretty much talk every day. And he jokingly said, "Why don't you just put my video up on the screen?" I said, "Oh, that'd be, I wouldn't mind that at all." But I love him so much, and I want to take part in that too. I want to participate. So I'm looking forward to looking at this text. Why would we call this one of the greatest events in history? Well, many titans of the faith in church history called this one of the greatest events in history. Medieval theologian Thomas Aquinas, he called this the greatest of all miracles. That's pretty superlative. Because the reason why, he says, is because on top of that mountain, God's will was done on earth as it is in heaven. We're going to unfold that this evening when we look at the text. J.C. Ryle says this about this particular passage of the Transfiguration. He says, it is a passage that we should always read with a peculiar thankfulness. I like that, a peculiar thankfulness. For it lifts a corner of the veil which hangs over the world to come. And it throws light on some of the deepest truths of our religion. I mean, I'm expecting that this evening. I want to experience the deep truths of what the Bible has to say about believers. I want to experience the deep truths about the personhood, the quality of Jesus Christ. Because I want to know how to emulate him better. I want to know how to be an example of him in a more deeper, intimate way. And the only way that I can do that is if I'm able and willing to listen to his voice as proclaimed in God's word. So that's what we're going to be looking at. I was thinking about this. I was like, wow, you know, J.C. Ryle says it kind of lifts the corner. It gives us a foretaste of the glory. And I was thinking about, you know, it's almost as if this evening is almost a couple of days. Remember when you were a kid before Christmas time? It was a couple of days before Christmas and the presents are out under the tree and you're waiting around for your parents to kind of be busy, you know? And you're just hoping for the small amount of chance to maybe see just a cracked corner of that wrapping paper, something that's a little bit unfolded. Because even if you could just see the color of the package inside, you could have some kind of hint of what you're going to get in anticipation and in excitement. Well, we're going to kind of crack the corner about seeing the glory of Jesus. We're going to crack the corner about what you will experience for all of eternity when we enter into the eternity and kingdom of Jesus Christ, either by his grace through our death into resurrection, or even as he comes back to receive us, his bride, the bridegroom coming for his bride. So I'm really excited about this. So, you know, this is true, the Transfiguration, because it gives us a real foretaste of Jesus' glory. Glory, you know, glory's interesting. Glory can, at least on this side of the veil, can only be really experienced in foretastes right now, right? Those small experiences, those intimate seasons that you have with God that can only be described as something that's glorious. When I was taking a pastoral class, when I was going through Bible college, we were asked as a class to define glory. And we would bring definitions, but whenever we would bring a definition of glory, in particular, God's glory, I'm not talking about how the earth sees glory. I'm not talking about how Americans see glory. I'm talking about how Christians, how Jesus is glorified. When we were asked to define the glory of God, those definitions, they never seemed adequate. They never seemed just up to par to what our fallible minds could comprehend. It never gave it the clearest justice. But what an encouragement to look upon the cross, to look upon a bleeding Savior who suffered on our behalf, and as the world sees as humiliating, we see that is glorious. He who has given us redemption, he who has paid the price for our sin, and experiencing now in a foretaste what we will experience for all eternity because of Jesus. What we can define, because what we do experience daily, is hope. As a believer in Jesus Christ, hope is always endless and inexhaustible, because this is what we have to look forward to. Hope is what we need to hear from an encouragement from Jesus and his Gospels, to be able to get through the day and be that proper salt and light that we are called to be. We just saw just previously what's demanded of us as Christians. And really, I think, at least in this narrative, for these three disciples, Peter, James, and John, that are witnessing the Transfiguration, this is what they needed. Just previously, it was revealed to them really what the true purpose of the Messiah was. Take a look just a couple of verses back in verse 22, where this is the first time Jesus revealed his purpose on this earth. He says, the Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes, be killed, and on the third day be raised. He says, that's my life purpose. Also, as my life purpose is, and as you're called to emulate me, this is also your life purpose, believer in Jesus Christ. He goes on and he says in verse 23, he says, if anyone wants to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. I mean, to the disciples, I don't want to, you know, give a whole review of what we looked at previously in our last section of scriptures, but for them to understand to take up a cross, that is revolutionary. That's to take up death. That's to take up Christ's agenda, not our own. That's to deny ourselves completely in order that Christ might be exalted, Christ might be glorified through really the expulsion of our own lives. Paul says this in a beautiful way in his epistle to the Philippians, Philippians chapter 3, verse 10 through 11. He says, I want to know him, that I may know him, meaning Jesus, that I may know the power of his resurrection. I say yes and amen to that, yes and amen to that. But then he says, and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Any means possible. The denial of myself, the expulsion of my own life for the cause of Jesus Christ. That's my heart's desire. That's Paul's heart's desire. And so to give these disciples hope, to show them what is anticipating through them for really what eternity has to offer, this is the experience they now have. And so It's even so much more than that. So let's just unfold it. Let's look at verse 28. It says, now about 8 days after these sayings, well, he's talking about just those previous verses that we mentioned, his teaching, he took with them Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. You know, these sayings, they correspond to the teachings of Jesus. And I think the way that Luke has written this structure out, Luke was an intellectual. I don't think he minced words or he wasted words. So I think there's a reasoning by saying, okay, 8 days after the teaching, after these sayings, he wants us to hold on to, kind of keep our thumb on the fact that Jesus is come to this earth to suffer and die and be resurrected, that Christians, disciples of Jesus Christ, ambassadors of Jesus Christ, are called to deny ourselves, to pick up our cross, and to follow him. We can't forget that narrative when we are experiencing the Transfiguration. He says they went up to a mountain to pray. We know from the other Gospels that when Jesus gave this teaching, they were at Caesarea Philippi, and a nearby mountain that would fit the environment of this narrative would be Mount Hermon near Caesarea Philippi, where there were places for privacy up on top of this mountain. And so, you know, he gathers these three men, and he goes up to pray. Now, I mentioned this before, but it draws us to remembrance, is that whenever Jesus prays in the Gospel of Luke, there's a divine interaction. There's this beautiful revelation that shows us more intimately who he is as the God-man, who he is as the perfect sacrifice for our sin, who he is in his righteousness. And so he grabs these men. He says, let's go pray. These guys having no idea what they're about to experience. And notice the word choosing. He says he takes with him. It's as if he's choosing Peter, James, John, you come with me. It was that proven reliance of leadership. Here's three men chosen from 12 disciples. 12 disciples chosen from thousands of followers, and thousands of followers really walking through as representatives of the entire rest of the world. These are the men that spread the gospel, that fulfilled the Great Commission. And friends, I want to let you know that in such a way, you as a believer in Jesus Christ, you're chosen too. You are chosen, specially chosen, to not only experience His Word, but have the Holy Spirit living and residing in you to illuminate what the world sees as foolishness. And in a way, transfigure you into the image of Jesus Christ. Luke 29, chapter 9, verse 29 through 31, says, as they were praying, he says, the appearance of his face is altered. His clothing becomes dazzling white, and behold, there's two men, and they're talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. It's kind of interesting. Here he is, he's praying, and as he's praying, there's this divine interaction. This appearance of his face is altered. I don't think this is something that Jesus is experiencing as something that he doesn't know that's happening. I think he's well aware, and he's chosen these men to experience that, because these men are in a place of responsibility to respond when God speaks. A responsibility when they experience God for who He is, that responsibility to act upon it. And we'll see at the end of the text that they're quiet, but we'll see later on how they act upon it later in the scriptures. And I mean, can you imagine? His face is altered. His clothing becomes dazzling white. Two men appear on either side of him. The experience would be a terrifying experience. But we see later on, what are the disciples doing? They're asleep. They're having a great nap time. And it's almost as if these things are happening outside of their knowledge. They're not really getting it yet. But Luke, as a writer, is wanting us to understand something here, that this is an event that's important not just for the disciples, it's important for Jesus on earth for this to occur. Notice it says that his appearance changes. Now that's important, because doctrinally we must understand that it's his appearance that changes, but not his nature. He is still God and man, perfectly, harmoniously, together. Never changing in that respect. It's almost as if, though, however, his divinity is overpowering his humanity at this point. In a way of perceiving that appearance. His face and clothing become dazzling white. Some translation says they're white like lightning. Matthew's account says his face, it shines. Excuse me, I'm spitting. Shines like the sun. And for this brief time, Jesus was transfigured. How do we define that? Trans means change. Figure means figure. He changes his appearance to an appearance more like the King of Glory than that of a humble carpenter. I love what one Bible commentator says. He says, this was not a new miracle. Well, it kind of is to us, right? This hasn't happened to Jesus before in this way, but he says, this is not a new miracle, but it's a temporary pause of an ongoing miracle. The real miracle was that Jesus, most of the time, could keep from displaying his glory. You get what I mean by that? It's more of a miracle for him to hold his glory back as a humble carpenter, instead of just letting it shine out. I want you to see me as I've always been before the foundations of the world. It was more of a miracle that he could hold it in than release his glory. I just love that. I want you to understand something here. Luke uses a rare word in the scriptures that's gonna I think, pull a thread for us to understand how this connects to Jesus' redemptive plan. Luke uses a rare word here in the scriptures concerning his appearance. Notice it says, his appearance of his face was altered. That word, appearance in the Greek, is the Greek word eidos, E-I-D-O-S. And it means what is visual changes. Now, we know that the New Testament is primarily translated from the Greek, and the Old Testament is primarily translated from the Hebrew, with a couple of smatterings of different languages that we find in Daniel. However, back then there was also a translation of the Old Testament in Greek called the Septuagint. And so that word eidos is also used all the way back in the explanation of the tabernacle in the book of Exodus. The Septuagint tells us in Exodus chapter 26, verse 30, it says, "Then you shall erect the tabernacle according to the plan being the Greek word eidos, for it that you were shown on the mountain." Well, what does that mean? I think Luke, as a writer, is wanting us to draw our attention to Jesus being the fulfillment of God's redemptive plan, not just in the New Testament, not just in the Old Testament, but even before the foundations of the world. Verse 30 here in Exodus shows us, verse 30 of Luke, it shows us this entrance of two men, Moses and Elijah. And they're appearing in glory, and they're having a conversation with Jesus. Don't you find that, amazingly just beautiful? Number one, that they could be experiencing something so terrifying, but to Moses and Elijah, there's this normalcy of conversation that they're encountering because of a friendship and closeness with Jesus. Think about it. In Jesus' display of his glory, here these guys have this wonderful opportunity of participation. Think about Moses. Who does he represent as we see in the Old Testament? He's representative of the law. The Lord used him to bring the law to the nation of Israel. God's moral standard, his degree of righteousness that is demanded upon every human being that sucks breath into their life. A man during the beginning of God's redemptive plan, he's ushering a chosen people to a promised land. And for this narrative, it's over 1,000 years ago. And in participating with Jesus, he's doing what he does best, what Moses does best. He's giving glory to Jesus. I just kind of think about it. It says that same glory that even he had a foretaste of when he was talking to this burning bush, hearing the voice of God, as God says, "I am that I am. I'm the ego eimi, the perfect, timeless one." Seeing that still same voice being spoken through the voice of Jesus as they're having a conversation. This representative of the law. Then we have Elijah. He's the representative of the prophets. Remember Elijah, he was caught up, right? In a chariot of flaming fire to heaven. He was this man of wisdom and power, especially in a time of great disobedience by the nation of Israel, great evil in the Old Testament. And he's participating as a means of saying, here's this mighty work of giving Jesus glory, saying that his promises never will fail, will never fail. And both of these men, the law and the prophets, they fulfill the entirety of the Old Testament, the entirety of proclamation to people that would be willing to hear. They fulfill that of divine revelation since the beginning of time, God's redemptive plan before the foundations of the world, all through the workings of history and now glorifying Jesus concerning his purpose. And what do they get to discuss? They could discuss the beauty of heaven. They could discuss the wonderful conversations that they have with the angels on a daily basis. They could discuss truly the expanse of God's sovereign power and orchestration in his creation. But no, what is the greatest thing on their minds? It's Jesus' departure to Jerusalem. Of all the things they could be discussing, what gives the greatest significance is Jesus' destination on the cross. His greatest purpose for him, his destination on the cross. It's interesting that word departure in the Greek is actually the word exodus. It's Jesus' exodus in fulfilling that plan that God has set for the salvation of all humanity. And this is why, you know, this is the application for us. What we hold in our hands, this word of God, of the entirety of the scriptures, what should hold dominance over every word that we experience is God's gospel of his son. That should hold the dominance of our thinking. If we're looking at any portion of the text, from Old Testament all the way through the New, we need to ask ourselves, how is Christ being represented? How is his gospel being shown? It's his work upon the cross that should have the greatest precedence when we speak. Friends, it's my desire as a pastor. I don't care where we are in the scriptures, expositionally. If I'm looking at a text, I want to see where is Jesus and how can I preach the cross? How can I preach Jesus more eloquently? How can I preach Jesus more dynamically? How can I, Lord Jesus, help me present Jesus in the right way? Because if we're just talking about other non-essential things, we miss out so deeply on this wonderful relationship with God. And friends, if I could be as bold to say, it's more important for Moses to speak to Jesus about his death and resurrection than it is about the law. For Elijah, it's more important for him to talk to Jesus about his death and resurrection than it is about his prophecy and the prophetic work. Both of those point to the cross, yes and amen. But they're talking about his departure in this specific way, his redemptive work. And so church, that should be on our minds all the time. Maybe I'm pushing it too hard. I don't care. It's every time that we gather, what should have the superiority in our discussion in this house, the superiority in our discussion, the superiority in our worship, in our prayer, more than any other thing, is Jesus' glorifying redemptive work. It bugs me to hear worship songs that don't have the name of Jesus in them. It bugs me. It breaks my heart. If his name is not proclaimed, I don't want to sing it. Because I can talk all day about my own issues. I can talk all day about my man-made solutions, my agenda, my hopes, my feel-good isms. It doesn't matter unless Christ is exalted and glorified. I was trying to think of a word, you know, how I would desire our church to be in discussing the gospel and experiencing the gospel of Jesus Christ and experiencing the cross and his resurrection. And the only word that I could think of, and maybe it's not adequate, I want our church to be gluttonous in desire for the work of Christ. I want our church to be gluttonous, and I just want this clear picture. Lord, you gave me such a clear picture on Sunday of just the magnitude of the price you paid for my sin. But God, this Sunday, I want an even more clear picture because I want to worship you more. I want to expel my life in a better way. I want to live like you in a better way. Look at verse 32. Here's these guys, and they just wake up, and they're experiencing this firsthand. Verse 32, now Peter and those who were with him, they were heavy with sleep. And when they became fully awake, bing, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. I mean, what do you think Peter was able to see? James and John. I mean, what a sight to wake up to. I'm more awake than I've ever been. If I wasn't sober, I'm sober now. My eyes are more open than ever before. I mean, what were they seeing? Luke, I think, intentionally doesn't give us the most specific description, because I think ultimately a description would just be inadequate. But John, here's a man who's experiencing the Transfiguration. John, later on, when he's on this island of Patmos, and the Lord is giving him the revelation of Jesus Christ, Revelation chapter 4 and 5, it speaks of this beautiful description of the throne. I mean, we could read all of Revelation 4 and 5 and just be amazed. That maybe is your homework for tonight. But could it be that capacity is as he's in, probably in terrifying fear, probably in just an absolute prostration before this revelation of God and seeing Jesus upon his throne, when he sees the Lamb that was slain that is worthy to take the scroll? Could it possibly be that he's like, I've seen this before. In some small foretaste, I've seen this before. Upon that mountain, I saw a degree of this glory, but never like this before. Oh, Lord, my prayer, our prayers, Lord, would we be fully awake, not sleeping to your orchestrations, not sleeping, Holy Spirit, to your working in our life and moving us and using us as instruments of righteousness. God, I do not want to be dreary-eyed, heavy eyelids when it concerns to the spiritual realm and your glory wanting to be experienced in my life, Lord. Forgive me, Jesus. Forgive me, Jesus, when I've been too sleepy spiritually, too sleepy to be a willing servant to pick up my cross and to follow you. Lord, make us awake to your promises, awake to our sin, awake. Lord, we know it says in Scripture that our iniquities number more than the hairs on our head. Is that possible? But you know them all. You paid for it all. That every time I'm reminded of my sin, Lord, you awaken me to your redemption. You awaken me to your grace that is new and inexhaustible every morning. And what do these guys do in experiencing the glory? Verse 33. And as the men were parting from him, it's talking, they're kind of distancing themselves away from the disciples as they're having this discussion. Peter says to Jesus, Master, it's so good. It's good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah, not knowing what he said. And as he was saying these things, a cloud came, overshadowed them. They were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my son. This is my chosen one. Listen to him. And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent and told no one in those days anything of what they had seen. So can you see the narrative in your mind? Can you kind of visualize the movie? They're kind of talking, Jesus is talking with Elijah and with Moses. And isn't it amazing that Peter automatically knows that's Moses and that's Elijah? Having never witnessed them before, I think just the understanding of those men, the law giver and the greatest prophet outside of John the Baptist, so encased in like Jewish DNA that they're just like, there he is, there they are. And Peter's awake and his eyes are open and he's like, what should I say? what would just fit the bill in this experience? And his desire is like, well, let's just stay here. Experiencing this glory. Let's just stay here. And friends, isn't that an honest desire? Especially when we've had seasons of just, man, just abundance in our spiritual life. Or maybe we've been to a retreat or a conference. Maybe you just went camping, got out of your tent and just experienced the glory of God's creation, and you're, I just want to stay here. I just want to be here. I don't want to leave. I mean, it's an honest understanding. It's his desire to stay. But even in Jesus' glory, Peter's perspective of the Messiah is off. Just off kilter again. We remember just previously that when Jesus asked him, "Who do you say that I am?" And Jesus says, "You're the Christ of God." We see in other synoptic gospels, Matthew and Mark, Jesus says, "Flesh and blood hasn't revealed this to you, but my Holy Spirit." And he commends Peter. But then Jesus goes on to talk about his suffering, and he goes to talk about his moving towards Jerusalem, being drawn almost by like a magnet to go to his crucifixion, his death, and ultimately his resurrection. And Peter says, "No, Lord, I'm not going to let that happen." Jesus' perspective of the Messiah is off. He's viewing him as this Jewish Messiah, this revolutionary, here to conquer. Jesus has come to conquer, but not in the way that they expect. And so it's again Peter trying to hinder Jesus. Maybe not intentionally, but coming to that logical conclusion, let's just stay here. Almost as if to say, Jesus, your kingdom, you've been preaching about this all along. And now, this is your glory. Your kingdom's here. Here's Moses. Here's Elijah. This is all that we need. Build it here. Let's build 3 tents, or in other words, 3 tabernacles. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. There's no need for an exodus. We don't have to depart. Just stay here. Friends, even in the sincerity of Peter's heart, this is absolute opposite of Christ's plan and work. Sincerity can mean a whole lot, but ultimately, if there's no action and there's no truth behind it, it doesn't mean anything. Here's this mountain. Jesus, just build this tabernacle, stay here, and people will come to us. We don't have to go to them. They can just see the glory on top of the mountaintop. They will come to us. As long as we can get there, here's this kind of man's hope of success, of accomplishing salvation. We can just reach to you if you just stay on this mountain, Jesus. I can fulfill it. I can get there. I know the path. I just need to walk up towards you. But Jesus says, Peter, I mean, I'm speculating here, but there's a greater mountain than Mount Hermon to accomplish my work. There's a mountain in Jerusalem. It's Mount Calvary that I am destined for, where you will not ultimately come. But I do the work of my Father, and I alone will accomplish salvation for you. Build 3 tabernacles. I mean, kind of in a way, Peter was right when he's talking about tabernacles, but in a sense, I want us to look at the comparison here. If you have your Bibles, look at Exodus chapter 40. We kind of have an Exodus theme this evening. Exodus 40, verse 34 and 35. It tells us that the tabernacle was filled with the cloud. Tabernacle was filled with the cloud and glory of God. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, it says here in verse 34. The glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle, and Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Let me just say it one more time, 34 and 35. The cloud covers the tent of meeting. The glory of the Lord fills the tabernacle. Moses is not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled to completion the tabernacle. Now we take verse 34 and 35 of Exodus 40, and we now compare it to verse 34 and 35 of Luke chapter 9. It says, as they were saying these things, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. I see this beautiful comparison. And I almost kind of like enjoy the fact that Moses is present at both occasions. He's here. But what does it say? Exodus 40 tells us that the tabernacle was filled with the cloud and glory of God. Same thing happens here. So Jesus in his transfiguration, what is he revealing? He's revealing that through the law and the prophets, he's the fulfillment of all of this. In fact, he is the living tabernacle, the dwelling of God with humanity to fully perform the final salvific duty on our behalf. And as John is witnessing this, I believe this is why he penned in the introduction of his gospel, he became flesh and dwelt among us. Christ is all that is needed for salvation. He fulfills all of that wonderful symbolism and picture of the need of a tabernacle, the need of a temple. And here, in kind of the climax of the experience, as they're terrified, they don't want to enter into that cloud of glory. Then they hear this voice. Verse 35, this voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my son. This is my chosen one. Listen to him." Listen to him. He says he's my chosen one. We need to understand from Scripture that God the Father is speaking here. Speaking of Jesus, the Son. He's saying he's his chosen one, not you are my chosen son because I'm choosing you to be a son. He's always been the Son of God, and he will always be the Son of God, but he is chosen to be that living tabernacle, to be that final salvation, that nail in the coffin of death itself, in order that you and me can actually be saved from our sins. We cannot climb the mountain. We cannot get to Jesus. We cannot get to that tabernacle. Christ must come off of the mountain down to us and die for us. And friends, we have this capacity. We have this temptation like Peter, to want to build our booths, build our experiences, build our traditions, build our carry-ons, and say, this is the spiritual life. This is the experience of Christ, where Christ is saying, not at all. Instead of our desire to build traditions and booths of human fashioning, can't we say that the voice of Jesus, the accolade that he received from God the Father, where God himself says, listen to him. Listen to him. Quit sleeping. Quit assuming. Quit pushing your own agenda. Quit defending your own sin. Listen to what Jesus has to say. Open your word and take it for the inestimable value that it is. We can't know anything about Christ unless he reveals himself to us. But wonder of wonders, he does. He reveals himself to us through his word and through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Unless Christ speaks, unless the Holy Spirit moves, the church is dead. The church is dead. Unless we can say, okay, I submit, I listen, I hear, and I respond. Jesus, speak. And I see so much of myself in the heart of the disciples. I mean, Jesus is he's being explicitly clear. And I see this even with my own children. When we tell them to do something, we can't make it much clearer, son. Do this. And I can just see the spokes turning. How can I compromise this and make it work to my own value? I mean, we laugh, sometimes I have to give timeouts, but ultimately I look at my own relationship with Christ and I see my own spokes turning. Think about it this way. The disciples, they spent 3 years with Jesus, okay? Think about that. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for 3 years. And they didn't get it until they saw him resurrected. That's 1,095 days. That's 26,280 hours of Jesus himself. And they didn't get it. Master's Divinity Seminary, you can get a Master in Divinity, a degree in theology and biblical studies for 80 hours of credit. 80 hours to fulfill your master's degree in divinity. These guys had 26,000 hours with Jesus himself, not just a theologian. And they couldn't get it because they did not listen to him correctly. These guys spent this time until they finally witnessed his resurrection, until the Holy Spirit descended upon Pentecost. They couldn't properly understand, but friends, when they did understand, they died. They were persecuted to the point of death because they said the message of Jesus Christ is more important than my own life. It's more beautiful. It's more fulfilling than my own desires and heart. It's who I am. We need more of the voice of Christ in our life, not less. More of his word, not less. More of his Holy Spirit, not less. We need less smoke and mirrors. We need more prayer and contemplation. We need less entertainment in the church and more of his Holy Spirit's power. Less messages on our best life now and more messages on Christ's best life in us and through us. His life that kills our flesh and makes us walk in his Spirit. That gives us the strength to stand up for truth and for righteousness. To have the ability to awaken our eyes in the morning and say, my eyes are staying awake, not just physically, but spiritually, Holy Spirit, to how you want me to live my life today. Glorify your work upon the cross. That's what his transfiguration is about. To give us that hope, that foretaste of glory. Paul says, and I've said this before, Paul says this in his epistle to the Romans, that the sufferings that we receive, the hardships, the toil, the strain, the obstacles, the physical maladies, the emotional sicknesses, they are nothing to be compared to the glory that will be revealed in you in eternity. We must be faithful to deny ourselves. I want more of him. I want to receive more of him. I want to experience more of him.